St. John's.
That's true, that's true.
I know. Figure after 4 years, you know, get it right.
Please come to order. Good morning, welcome to the Commission of St. Mary's County meeting this date, Tuesday, December 11th, 2018. I am Randy Guy, President of Commission of St. Mary's County. I'd like to introduce the other commissioners. Sitting to my right, Representative First Commission District, which includes Ridge, Piney Point, St. Charles Island, Mr. Eric Coleman.
Good morning.
Representing the Second Commission District, which includes Leonardtown and Hollywood, Mr. Mike Hewitt.
Good morning.
Sitting to my left, unfortunately, John O'Connor, who represents the Third Commission District, which includes Charlotte Hall, 7th District, Golden Beach, McCandless, was unable to be here today because he had a very important appointment with the VA hospital up in Washington. Representing the Fourth Commission District, which includes Lexington Park, some of California, and Great Mills, and some of Hollywood, Todd Morgan. Seated at the end of this, Dr. Rebecca Bridget, our county administrator. On my immediate right is Bonnie Gray, our recorder. Amy Carter, our video media producer, is behind the glass. Please turn your cell phones off or on vibrate. When you come to the presenter's table, please approach by coming down the center aisle. And remember, this meeting is being televised. You need to speak clearly and directly into the microphone for recording purposes. Reminder, we will be holding a joint meeting with the St. Mary's County delegation tonight at 6 p.m. in this meeting room to discuss legislative proposals. At this time, we'll have the invocation and pledge by Commissioner Morgan. Please stand.
Please bow your heads. As we enter into this holiday season, let us be ever mindful of the needs of others. It is more blessed to give than to receive, and for us all to be respectful of the needs of others. May we look forward to tidings of joy for families, friends, and neighbors, and the blessings of the world around us. All this we ask in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Pledge allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mr. Morgan. I need a motion for the approval of the consent agenda.
I move to approve the consent agenda, which includes minutes of December 4, 2018, as presented.
Second.
I have a first, second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it. Next, we have the Office of the County Attorney decision for a proposed ordinance on commercial dock use.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Good morning.
David Weistoff, County Attorney's Office. We're here today to get your decision on the proposed moratorium for commercial dock use. We had a public hearing on this back August 28th, and then we initially had public comment period for 7 days based on the amount of public comment that was extended until December 4th, and since that time, I think a grand total, you had 353 people in support of the moratorium and 27 people opposed, if you were to count everything and the speakers that were at the original meeting and all the petitions and letters that have come in. To give a quick background on it, what we had is this was brought forth by Land Use and Growth Management originally, and it's because the state of Maryland has revised its aquaculture laws to actively promote the expansion of aquaculture operations and authorized water column leases for shellfish aquaculture. Water column leases have been and are likely to continue to be granted by the Maryland Department of Natural Resources for the waters surrounding the St. Mary's County Peninsula. The waters surrounding St. Mary's County have had almost twice as many shellfish aquaculture leases as any other county in Maryland, with one exception. The rapid expansion of industrial aquaculture operations in the waters surrounding St. Mary's County will necessarily result in an increase of industrial and commercial seafood processing operations, including the onloading and offloading of equipment, spat, and shellfish at various docks, piers, and marinas throughout the county. And the expansion of industrial and commercial seafood processing and uses raise a number of concerns to the commissioners, including ensuring that the rapid expanding aquaculture industry is managed in a fashion that reduces user conflicts and is done in harmony with St. Mary's County land use planning efforts and consistently with the public health, safety, and welfare of the residents of St. Mary's County. And so we're here today, I'm here today to ask if commissioners have want to come to a decision on it.
So you're saying out of
380 people, 353, 27 people were opposed to the moratorium, and 353 were in support of it?
Yes, sir.
So that's roughly about 90% of the people who responded are in support of the moratorium?
I'll take your word for the matter.
Well, yeah, don't get me wrong. I usually think about that before I say it. Sure. My point being is that that's quite a few people in support of the moratorium. Now, what we heard from people who were opposed to it was like, this is a NIMBY thing, not in my backyard.
Right.
And I think what we heard at the public hearing was it's not a NIMBY thing. It's a thing about this is recreational area I've used for a long time.
Right.
That's now being taken away from me. So from that perspective, it's time to make a decision. Now, something that's changed is we have two new delegates. Well, actually, we have a new state senator and a new delegate in Annapolis, and I think they should be given an opportunity to work on this, see if they can find some kind of middle ground that strikes a balance between the people who want to do these types of things. We're all in support of the Bay aquaculture. But personally, I think I have to support installing the 18-month moratorium. I'm not making a motion right now, we're just discussion. But I'm saying I support the 18-month moratorium because I think it gives us two cycles of the legislature. The new people will need some time to get their feet on the ground and understand it. And with two cycles, we could hopefully come to some resolution here that satisfies all the stakeholders. If we were to go for something less than 18 months, what would be the ramifications of that?
Well, it would depend whether it was enough time to get it done, I guess.
No new public hearing required.
No new public hearing required, because you're not changing the proposed ordinance that much. I would like to note out, speaking of changes to the ordinance, we did make one minor change, and I want to make sure that you all are aware of that, and that is in the, to find it, forgive me. That is in the section one, where we say direct county staff to study these matters, finalize their recommendations, and propose any changes to the St. Mary's Comprehensive Plan. And we added and St. Mary's County Comprehensive Zoning Ordinance, because it really is both things that we would have to take a look at. So I just wanted to make sure that you were aware of that. Not a major change, but just so that you know what you're voting on. But in terms of if you reduce the time, obviously if you reduce the time, maybe you're thinking that one round in the legislature is enough for our delegates to get a handle on things, or as you initially said, 18 months would allow two go-arounds. I know that some of our commissioners have been involved in the Tiger team at the state level. I don't know if they've, where the progress is in that, if that's looking good. So there's other things going on besides just what we're proposing today that we're hoping we'll be able to allow some changes to it. And as well as what this moratorium does is allows the county staff to study it and recommend any changes to the existing uses or, for the betterment of the citizens.
But we can always lift the moratorium if something happens sooner.
That's correct. And we actually put that language in the proposed ordinance.
Versus if something happens
at the state level that we
doesn't would. Happen and we need an extension of time, mm-hmm. Is that any detriment to that?
And if you wanted to, if this was implemented and then something changed, or Lugham was able, or county staff was able to do their, study and propose amendments, to the zoning ordinance or comp plan in a rapid fashion, you can always come back and end the rescind the ordinance at any time. And
I'd say everybody's plenty busy, so a rapid fashion, that's not, it's careful what we wish for.
Certainly.
So I think it's important what Commissioner Hewitt said, that everybody up here is in favor of aquaculture. We're not opposed to aquaculture. I think my understanding of this issue is the way that the state has mandated it down, and there needs to be a change at the state level. And this ordinance is an attempt to encourage the state to move along with that as part of it.
Well, that might be true, but what we're really focused on is making it if changes are necessary at the county level.
Okay.
At our comprehensive zoning ordinance to more regulate dock use. You know, how much is, they need to study it.
Okay, so I think I would be in favor of reducing it to 6 months, 180 days. And that we still have the option that gives time for our new delegation to try to work at the state level, try to make some changes. And we can still go back and add on to it later on if we need to. That's what I would support. We talk a lot about economic diversification, and this is one way of economic diversification for the county. And I don't want to impose any more restrictions on people trying to run a business than are already out there. So I guess I would make a motion to amend this to 6 months instead of 18 months.
And I sort of support that. I would like to give us time to look at it. And I understand we have a new delegate, a new senator coming into play. And our new senator, of course, is a 30 plus year DNR police officer, retired. And he already has a pretty good handle on this situation now. And I think I want to give him and all the delegation time to look at this and see what they can do. And now, if we go to the 6 month, 180 days, will we be able to add on to this without another whole new round of public hearing, another?
We'd have to have more public hearing.
So 180 days, this would end, mm-hmm. and then we'd have to do another proposal.
Or you could obviously start it before the you could obviously start a new proposal before the 180 days ends to extend it.
Right.
You know, roughly probably 3.5-4 months.
Right.
Which another benefit is then people who are impacted by it can have more input. They'll realize they're impacted by it.
True.
But it would require another public hearing.
Yes.
So be it. Yes. It's our job.
It would be another new public hearing. That's for sure. Yeah. Which I think would be good.
Yeah.
Everybody's had a chance to look at this and study it a little closer. Well, we have to do something to force the hand of DNR. No doubt about it, they're not being very responsive. I've been on this group up in Annapolis for the last few months back, and they're a pretty hard stand on the legislation that's been passed. I am personally for a 180-day, 6 month rather than 18 months.
Okay, well, there was a motion. I don't know that it's been seconded.
I second it. We have a motion to change the motion from 18 months to 180 days. Do you want to read the whole motion with 180 days in it? Is that how we need to do it?
Yes.
Okay. Go ahead and read the motion with the 180-day change into it.
So.
Do you have a copy of that?
Gotcha.
Yep.
So I move to approve the proposed ordinance that imposes a moratorium on commercial dock use associated with the on and offloading of seafood catch from new DNR authorized water column shellfish aquaculture leases for a period of 180 days.
Okay, I have a first and second on that motion. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
No. And I will note that two commissioners passed this versus a majority of the commissioner board.
That is true.
Say again?
It was two commissioners to make this made this pass versus a majority of the commissioner board. That's just a note for the record. This is a majority of what's here, but it's a note for the record.
Three is a quorum.
That's right. I know.
Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, next we move right into the county administrator's side.
Thank you, commissioners. And first on your agenda is to review your draft agenda. So next week is December 18th, your last meeting of the year. You do have your FY18 audit presentation. You also have your Department of Public Works and Transportation request for public hearing for the airport rules and minimum standards. Also from the Office of the County Attorney, a request for public hearing for the ethics ordinance. You also have a personnel session scheduled that morning for executive session. You adjourn and return to this room for your budget work session, which does begin at 2 p.m. That day. Then you break for the holidays. Just a note that there are no meetings for the commissioners the week of December 25th or January 1st. So you resume in 2019 on January 8th. You do have your regular meeting with the Board of Health here in this meeting room. Also, two public hearings, Office of the County Attorney for your ethics ordinance public hearing, and the Department of Public Works and Transportation for the Airport Rules and Minimum Standards public hearing. You adjourn and then return that evening for your first public forum of 2019 at 6:30 p.m. in this room. For this morning's business meeting, we begin with item B from the Department of Finance to present the award recommendation for taxiway relocation and the West Apron project. Brandon Hayden, Procurement Manager and Contracting Officer, and Jeanette Cudmore, CFO, presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
So we are here to receive concurrence to award the project to relocate Taxiway A and expand the West Apron. The solicitation was posted to the email and marketplace on June 14th, where 685 potential bidders were notified of the solicitation. Additional bidders were notified by the county website. A pre-bid meeting was held on June 27th with 12 representatives from 7 different interested bidders attending. 3 amendments to the solicitation were posted to respond to bidder questions and requests for additional information following the pre-bid meeting, and 4 bids were received before the bid opening date of July 25th at 3 p.m. We are here seeking award concurrence to the Penn Ave Construction LLC in the amount of $6,498,308 for this project, subject to receipt and acceptance of contract-related documents.
I'm just glad to see we're moving down the runway, no pun intended. Mr. President, I would move to approve the procurement officer to execute the contract award to Penn Avenue Construction LLC of Prince Frederick, Maryland for the relocation of Taxiway A and expand apron area at the St. Mary's County Regional Airport, subject to receipt and acceptance of contract-related documents.
Second.
I have a first and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioners. And item C is from the Department of Human Resources to request the mid-year position reclassification. Catherine Pratson, Director for the Human Resources Department, and Jeanette Cudmore, CFO, presenting. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Commissioners. Today I'm following up on the mid-year position reclassification request presented last week during the December 4th budget work session. The position reclassification process presents an opportunity to ensure that positions are assigned to the proper class based upon the duties and responsibilities of the position. Positions are evaluated and ranked based upon the supervision received or exercised, the complexity of work, the impact of decisions, the relationship with others, and the physical demands and hazards experienced while in the position. In summary, 108 employee reclassifications were submitted through September of 2018, representing 50 different positions. HR reviewed the submissions, ranked the positions, and notified employees of the determination. All employees were provided with the opportunity to appeal the HR determination. 15 employees submitted appeals. The appeals were sent to an independent HR consultant. And at the end of the day, 73 reclassifications are recommended, representing 33 different positions, and 15 of these positions are vacant. The FY19 mid-year salary increase from the proposed reclassification request totals $121,666, with an estimated annual increase of $243,000. The attached table provides the detail for the proposed reclassifications. The positions that are italicized are the ones that are vacant. Approved reclassifications result in placement on the scale in the new grade with a salary increase to the employee of 4%. Additionally, a request to change position titles for communication specialists from communication specialist to public safety dispatcher has been submitted. The requested title changes include communication specialists 1 and 2 to be titled public safety dispatch 1 and 2, communication specialist 3 to be titled public safety dispatch assistant supervisor, and communication specialist 4 to be titled public safety dispatch supervisor. 3 is the assistant supervisor, 4 would be supervisor. And then hourly communication specialist to be titled public safety hourly.
Would you repeat the last one, please?
Sure. The hourly?
Yeah.
Hourly communication specialist would be titled public safety hourly.
Okay.
I don't know if you have any questions while you look at the chart.
One question. Of the 15 employees that submitted an appeal, how many of those were upheld or?
One.
One. Uh-huh. So one change came about because of appeal. Okay.
Yes.
And Ms. Press, is this something that you and the HR do on a yearly basis?
Yes, so okay. We would like very much to. We did this last year. The commissioners approved reclassifications mid-year last year. It's a very typical process in compensation systems that have grades and classes. So with governmental systems, with the federal government, with state government, and with county governments.
Very good. Okay. Any other questions, commissioners?
I move to approve the recommended FY19 mid-year position reclassification requests effective January 1st, 2019, and to approve the recommended emergency services communications specialist title changes.
Second.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you, commissioners. And item D is from the Department of Emergency Services to present the ENSB grant approval. Steve Walker, director, presenting this morning. Good morning.
Good morning. So this is simply a request for you to approve funding that we received from the Emergency Services Numbers Board. This very specifically, if you recall, we have promoted a person to a training coordinator last July. We are now doing training academies for our dispatchers. Actually started our second one this week, and this is actually going to enable us to be able to do that much more efficiently. We also have a number of people that go outside of the county to Prince George's, Charles, and Calvert, and this will allow us to provide the person that goes out with a computer to be able to take with them to use during those times. So again, I have Mr. Manley here as our training coordinator. Could tell you the value of that if you so desire. I want to ask him some questions, but I'm asking that you approve the funding so we can proceed with this project.
So you're going to get 6 of them for $5,900?
That's correct. Yes, sir.
You get better deals than a lot of people get around here.
We got the quote from IT, so this goes right along with what the rest of us use. So.
Just so FYI for myself, I know at one time we talked about the consoles that the dispatchers use and how I remember when Harris was in here, they said there could be some disconnect there, that those may need to be replaced. Are they replaced? Are they being replaced? Are they going to be?
That isn't a capital improvement request.
Okay, that's part of what we're
doing. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, good. Thank you.
Any questions, commissioners?
Well, I move to accept the funding from the Emergency Services Numbers Board under Project MD-1938 to purchase 6 laptop computers to be used by the Department of Emergency Services and their dispatcher training programs, and also approve the budget amendment increasing the grant project by $5,970 for a total of $1,618,474, and authorize the commissioner president to execute all related documents.
Second.
I have a first and second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Thank you,
Mr. Walker.
Thank you, commissioners. And item E is the review of your commissioner president ministerial acts. So this is the review of the resolution of 2015-56, which delegates certain ministerial acts to the commissioner president. And we ask you today to consider increasing authority for budget amendments if you so desire. So in a review of the information in calendar year 18, there were 42 ministerial acts completed and two budget amendments under $1,000. There were an additional 11 budget amendments that were in the range of $1,000 to $5,000, which could be processed administratively by Commissioner President Guy should the commissioners choose to amend the resolution.
Was there a problem? Are we correcting something that's a deficiency, or what's the idea behind this?
No, not a problem. We review every year and just give you data points in case you're interested in them. So if it's really up to the commissioners if you think that that's increase of inefficiency or if you leave it the same.
Well, if you give the commissioner president this authority, will the other commissioners be informed of these decisions, say quarterly or semi-annual?
If the board would like to, yes, absolutely. Happy to give a status report.
Any more discussions?
I move to approve resolution 2015-56 as amended.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed?
Thank you, commissioners. And item F is the annual review of your delegation of authority for the county administrator. This is resolution 2016-39. And the commissioners of St. Mary's approved this delegation of administrative authority to increase efficiencies of government operations. Based on experience, the county administrator and the department's heads offer additional routine items that the commissioners may wish to consider. And their attachments in board docs are the cover memo, which offers the six current delegated authorities. Also, the Delegation of Executive Functions County Administrator Tracking Sheet and the draft resolution. So today, for your consideration, are a few amendments. And again, we just keep track of this throughout the year of things that commissioners have asked. Why could it be? Why is it delegated authority or not? The first one is if you would like to raise your grant application request from $25,000 to $35,000. That does not change your budget authority, only the grant request. If the request is actually received, then that comes on your agenda as a budget amendment to adjust your budget allocation. The second is to approve a transfer of disposal equipment to a government entity. Currently, the county administrator has authority to dispose of equipment to nonprofit entities. You might remember this year you looked at the judge of the orphans court asked for disposal of computers. That's an opportunity to be able to transfer it within government entities as well as nonprofit entities. So it allows that to happen if that's approved. The third is the release of liability when approved by the county attorney and required by state and federal entities. This past year, granting authorities added language in their grants. And so their routine releases that go with your grants, oftentimes you see them in large grants anyway. And so if the smaller grants accompany them, would you like to delegate that authority? The fourth one is the three-notch trail. This is when it's required for an easement or crossing, and it does require coordination oftentimes with SMECO. So oftentimes once SMECO gives the approval, then we automatically approve because the utility replacement would be taken care of.
Again, so that would only be for the three-notch trail?
Yes, those are just designed for the three-notch trail.
Because I know when we saw this SHA thing about the Route 4 235 intersection, they were talking about eliminating all those entrances onto 235 for the eyeglass place and stuff like that, and they would have to cross the railroad right away, so that wouldn't be part of this.
Right, it would not be. Those would come to your attention.
I my personal opinion is the railroad right away has been a very volatile issue around here.
I agree.
For any number of years.
I agree.
And at this point in time, my position is that I would be opposed to this across the board until, you know, because this runs north to south across the county. It's been a developer issue, it's been a SMECO issue, it's been a whole bunch of issues, and I really believe that the ultimate authority of what who granting what belongs to the board, And I'm not really, I'm personally not, would not be in favor of deferring anything across the railroad right away that the commissioners don't have a say on, because times change, people change, boards change. I'm against number
so is it, nine. If it's okay with the board as we go through these, I'll just cross that one off. Again, you know, it's a comfort level of the board for delegation, and so my recommendation is these are kind of easy for you to say, yep, that one goes, and if not, then just keep it in the commissioner authority. Is that okay with the board?
I'm good with that.
Okay. And then
I'm good.
And then number five is the approved modifications or amendments to current agreements that have no financial impact. The reason this came up is you might remember in October, Rex and Parks came up with a request for three parking spaces that were to be used in MOU at Town Creek. And so the question becomes if you still want those on your agenda or if that makes sense for delegated authority. So that's why it's listed.
Yeah, this one, contractor and drug spaces, yeah.
This one makes me nervous. It just seems, it's nothing against you, Dr. Bridget. It just makes me nervous.
Yeah, so again, these are the ones, you know, we try, just cross it off. You know, the commissioners should be comfortable with these, and I would just recommend, if it's consensus, we just pull it out. No problem. And then the last one is the letter of support for nonprofit entities requires currently a verification of tax status, a grant application, and a draft letter. Oftentimes, the turnaround time is pretty quick. And so if you'd like to delegate that authority to either the county administrator or the commissioner, the commissioner president. Currently, how we do that is if there's time and we can meet the deadline, then we usually place those on your consent agenda. And so these would only be in those times that are in between.
That's okay.
And so with that, we'll answer any additional comments or questions that you may have.
I would like some kind of presentation. I know we don't normally do presentations here. We usually do decision making. But some kind of presentation on why these railroad right-of-way easements are such a thorny issue.
Okay.
I know the guy that had the eye doctor place where they did Starbucks and stuff, and I remember meeting a long time ago. Anyway, his point was he wanted to be able to go across that railroad right-of-way to be able to get into the parking lot of First Colony and that driveway there, and they wouldn't let him. So all his customers have to go back out onto 235. And it just made sense that if he could have that, it would make his business probably a little bit better, but it would also get people off of 235 versus bring them in on a crowded spot and then back out. So some idea why we're restricting. Do you know, Todd, why are we restricting people from using it?
The argument has always been landowner property rights and the ability to access property on the other side of the right-of-way off of the main thoroughfares. And the railroad right-of-way has always been, you know, the longest pole in the tent.
Yeah, I agree.
And we've had a lot of discussions in the 8 years that I've been here relative to getting across the railroad right-of-way and who has the jurisdiction to open up the railroad right-of-way. You know, if you use the example, like Starbucks down there by...
Yeah,
the eye doctor place. I mean, yeah, but I mean, one of the problems there is, yeah, you go in and the parking's limited.
Oh, yeah, it's...
But we also know that that's where the new 235 is supposed to go, and I don't know, the state's negotiating all that stuff right now. But as you go all the way up the road, you know, through up to Mechanicsville North, that railroad's still there. And there's always been a lot of problems with who gets over the railroad track and who doesn't over that right of way. Besides, the utility has the eminent domain piece of it, but it becomes a developing issue and a commissioner issue. It's been very, very contested long before I was a commissioner. So I don't think, I'm opposed to giving up the ability to control development over those railroad rights, not just for this board, but for future boards. If you're willing to say, okay, somebody else can just do it, we're going to delegate it away. It's sort of like, you know, some of the other discussion, where there's things I just don't think, we're elected to represent the citizens' and overall interests. I don't think when you are looking at this thing, something that is valuable as the real estate along 235, those major highways, is something that we should be delegating away because we have no idea where the future
is. Well, look, I'm not talking about delegating away or bringing it around. It just doesn't make sense to me that you get a place that's doing a lot of business, has a lot, and then we're introducing that traffic back out into the already overcrowded road anyway. It just makes sense that you would have a relief valve. Now, I'm not talking about we would, you know, designate it to somebody else. I'm fine with it being a commissioner deal. I just don't understand the reason behind not wanting people to go over it. I mean, I just don't, what is the nexus of that? Is it they're going to break it or something? I just don't understand why.
They think they're going to build a new railroad?
That's not going to happen.
You're
not going to build a new railroad because all the railroad, once you put these right-of-ways over the railroad's gone. Yeah. So we get that part. But there has been, like, when you look at how the railroad, if I go down towards, like, where Foot Locker is, yeah, 235, and you think about there's a patch of, there's office space in there where you wanted to put the proposed FDR Boulevard if you ever went from Peg to
Great Mills Road.
That's the railroad track through there. And the reason that space is there and that mound is there, that's the railroad track. And so when there was a lot of discussions years ago, as Commissioner Hewitt knows, you know, do you usurp the authority of the commissioners to use that property? I just think it's a commissioner's decision for the future, and I don't want to...
Again, we're talking apples and oranges. I don't have a problem with whose decision it is.
Okay.
It's just that I would say you can't build anything on it. But if you were to put a right-of-way through it or something, now they come along and say, hey, look, we're going to take that right-of-way, you know, we're going to influence that, or we're going to take it out because we're putting another railroad in. That's an extreme example. My point being is if they want it back, i.e. the Metcom or Smetco, whoever's there now, they get it back. But for not to allow people just to be able to drive across it, it's a part
that I think that it has more than to do than just driving across it. I would say let's go up to the North Hollywood area where the railroad right away exists. What if in the future that property gets rezoned from whatever it is to, and you get water and sewer something up there? That property goes from relatively low value to high value, but has limited value if you don't have right away going across it.
Are we in the business of limiting values?
I don't think we're in the business of limiting values, but I think that the ability to get across that railroad right away then becomes sort of pretentious as to where the development goes and who gets the crossing.
All right. But again, if you can give us some idea of what started all this and it was done this way.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay. And last on the county administrator's agenda is the board docs implementation plan. So this provided in your board docs as a summary memo, the updated board docs implementation plan, and a sample letter that would go out to your boards if you so desire. So just a reminder, commissioners, that the commissioners have used board docs since 2014. With the board docs pro application, the county is able to add boards, commissions, and committees to the electronic meeting software program. By expanding the use, the county enhances public transparency and increases the opportunity for public engagement. Of course, it also easily meets the requirements of Open Meetings Act with the electronic prompts and more efficiently manages our record retention schedules. So far, the Emergency Services Board, the Youth Advisory Committee, LOSAP, OPEB are all using board docs and have their meetings on video. We've provided board docs orientation to the Planning Commission, to the Board of Appeals, to the Sheriff's Office Retirement Plan, and they're also scheduled to begin board docs after the first of the year. Also orientation to the persons with disabilities as well, who asked to expedite their project in board docs. The Planning Commission and Board of Appeals is already being videoed, and so they will be added to board docs also. SORP is also on the list for after the first of the year. EDC, the Economic Development Commission, Recreation and Parks, and Wicomico Shores are all scheduled for the January-February timeframe. So in short, you have 25 mandatory boards. They are listed as either advisory, legal, legislative, regulatory, or internal on your board docs implementation plan. They're the first three pages. There are two boards that are exempt based on the confidential nature of their material. And then the last portion at pages 4 and 5 are voluntary boards. Those are body politic and corporate. They're state boards, regional boards, or authority boards. There are 15 of them, and one of them is exempt as well, based on confidential nature of the subject matter.
Could I ask you a question?
Sure.
Before I lose my mind. Item F, Delegation of Administrative Authority Annual Review.
Yes.
Did we vote on that?
You did not.
Hey, I'm paying.
Thank you so much.
So before we go to F, could we please vote on G?
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome. I would move to amend Resolution 2016-39 for calendar year 2019, but strike items number 9 and number 10.
Thank you.
Okay, we're back on the previous.
Yeah, because we never voted on
F. I jumped ahead. My apologies.
Okay. I guess second.
Thank you.
I have a first and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Any opposed? Ayes have it.
Now we're back on track.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes, but I'm not.
It's okay. I know you're anxious.
Myself.
You're anxious.
I have 3 items in a row. So in summary, we have 17 meetings in the commissioners' meeting room, and 8 that would need to move to the commissioners' meeting room to be compliant in this room with the equipment and the videotape. And there is a letter, as I mentioned, in board docs to send to them. With the accelerated schedule, we should be completed with your mandatory boards by the end of the fiscal year. So with that, I open it up for questions.
So I think we've got a couple things mixed together here.
Okay.
All of our boards and commissions currently are meeting the Open Meetings Act requirements, correct?
So there are a few that we are counseling that we need to bring into compliance
right.
with the Open Meetings Act. And so if you look
at...
The vast majority, right. Yes, sir.
Okay. So meeting in this room is not a requirement of the Open Meetings Act. Live video feed is not a requirement of the Open Meetings Act.
That's correct.
So I'm fine with boards that are willing to do that, doing that, but the boards that are already succeeding but still meeting the Open Meetings Act, I don't think we should force them to change their method of proceeding.
Such as?
A board might meet somewhere else. I don't know. I've heard there's controversy with other boards. If
City
they meet somewhere else.
Seafood.
That's a, yeah.
They want to meet where they're meeting now.
Let them meet there, as long as it's ADA accessible and yeah. Open Meetings Act.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. I would concur with that. I mean, there's sometimes it isn't worth ruffling the feathers, yeah. No pun intended, to drag yeah. everybody in here, stick yeah. them on TV, and no one's paying attention anyways.
Right.
And I've not seen in the 8 years I've been here, I've never seen an event where any of the boards, commissions, or whatever have violated anything. It's just a matter of, you know, location, location, location. And while, you know, this might, location might be good for 90% of the time, 10% of the time might be suitable somewhere else and do just as good a job
right.
as sitting here and having Amy videotaping you.
And they can still videotape it and publish a recorded video later. That's meeting with the Open Meetings Act. There's nothing wrong with that.
I don't think of it.
No, that's right. Absolutely okay.
Right.
But our video capabilities and equipment, so there's
right.
two things. Board docs, your electronic meeting
right.
software is available in this room. These computers are stationary, so
right.
they're available for every board that meets in this room. They're not available in other meeting locations. So,
but
for
board docs is still available in other locations.
Yeah.
That's
yeah.
not limited to just this room.
Right.
right,
only the equipment. So the
right.
equipment would be the laptops and the video capabilities. So it's equipment.
But technically, there's 10 seats here. And some of our boards and commissions have more than 10 members.
Yes.
So it's impossible. It may be impossible
right.
physically to stick 10 people here, 10 computers, and get it all to work. However, in some of the previous cases, as Commissioner Coleman points out, there have been they're meeting the intent of the law with no problems.
So I've heard many times the other commissioners on this board talk about not liking the state to do the one size fits all down to the counties, and I don't think we should do that to the people who are supporting our county either. That's just my opinion.
I agree. And another thing, if we do increase it to have everybody here, we're probably going to have to increase our own staffing to fill this. If we have all, 40
boards meet here and videotape and everything, I don't think our present video producing people can handle it. It'd have to be additional FTE or part-time or something come on board to help us.
Mm-hmm. We would need additional resources. Okay, well, good. Thank you very much. So at this point, it is the commissioner's consensus that it's voluntary for folks for both board docs and videotape?
Yes.
Yeah. That'd be a fair statement?
That's fair.
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you very much. Much appreciated. And that concludes county administrator time.
Thank you, Dr. Brittany. Okay, now we go right into commissioner time, and we'll start right with Commissioner Morgan.
Thank you, Mr. President. This morning we had a joint meeting with the Board of Education that won't be on the video until a couple of days from now. I will say it was very productive. I think that what we have to understand is that with the budgets forthcoming, with legislative agendas for Kerwin and things like that, we're still in a very fluid state. But I would sit there, I would say from my point, I thought it was a very productive meeting. We got a very good update from Mr. Wyatt on where we're going with school security. I think that the commissioners have, you know, we put our money where our mouth is and been giving them the dollars that they need to promote security. We know that the legislature passed much more stringent rules last year on having patrol officers, SROs, other types of individuals in the schools. That money budget issue will be coming up. Also that there are some constraints now on the way we're going to be able to recapitalize and refurbish our schools based upon new budget formulas. Please, folks, bear in mind, this stuff has all been dictated and legislated, and all we have no choice but to follow what the legislature has said. So I want to thank Dr. Smith, the Board of Ed, and everybody for their time this morning to what was a good meeting. Tonight, we will be meeting with some of our legislators who are currently in their seats and the ones who have been recently elected and are freshmen. They're on a bus tour, so we'll be going able to go over this evening our legislative agenda for Annapolis this coming year. Roads. I'm happy to say, really happy to say, the striping and the paving on Sanders Church Road is finally done. The cones are gone, the striping is down, you know, everyone's going to do Christmas shopping with great cheer now. Maybe the stores will open up. We'll see along the way, but anyhow, after we opened that store, Harris Teeter, in January, this is December, 11 months later. I apologize as the commissioner that represents that district, but this is a developer and a state highway issue. But many times in the commissioner job, we get all the credit for everything that goes bad and none of the credit for anything that goes good. So I'm just happy to say Sanders Church Road is open. Now, on top of that, I've been sitting here for 8 years. And I've been after this road called F. Deer Boulevard. Today, we're going to have a ribbon cutting for the first 3/4 miles of F. Deer Boulevard being completed. So 8 years, 3/4 mile. Sounds corny, but it's done. And if you haven't driven yet, it's a really easy road to use. And if you want to get off 235 and get to St. Louis Church Road, and you get stuck in that light there at Old Rolling Road, you make the left-hand turn, go around a half a circle, come back up, no streetlights, no other thing, then you're at the other side of Harris Teeter, and you're ready to roll. So I'll see everybody today at 1, because I'm really excited about all this. And with that, we'll see you next week. Thank you.
You're next, Eric. All right.
Yeah. Thank you. First off, thank you to the Ridge Volunteer Rescue Squad. Commissioner Guy and Commissioner Hewitt and I were down there Saturday night, and we had a wonderful dinner. There's just some great volunteers that are doing some great work down there. It was just a really good time, so I was very happy to be there. To add on to what Commissioner Morgan said, it took him 8 years to get FDR open, and I've teased him about this. I've got it open the second week I've been on the job, so I hope the enterprise makes note of that, and you can expect those kind of results from me. In 2 weeks, we're going to open the next section. Just kidding. But I thought that, so hopefully that'll be a good ribbon cutting today. And also, as Commissioner Morgan said, it was very fitting that we were meeting with the school board this morning and hearing the security update after the lockdown that took place at Great Mills High School last week. And just want to commend everybody for a job well done on that. Our Sheriff's Department and school system worked very well together, and that's good. And I want to conclude with a little bit of trivia. In the classic Christmas movie, White Christmas, you might be interested to know that Dean Jagger, the actor who played General Waverly in White Christmas was actually younger than Bing Crosby in the movie. So I thought that was an interesting fact. So there you go.
Let's keep that in mind next time I watch that movie.
There you go.
Went to the rescue squad thing the other night in Ridge, and it was another great event. But you know what I noticed going in there is there's fewer tables. And I remember the people I sat with, I was sitting with them, and they're big members there. They do a lot of calls. And I said, you know, it looks like it's shrinking. And they said, yes, Mike, it is. They said, the way we're making it look like we have more people is we have less tables. It's a reason for concern. Because Lord knows we need these EMS, we need these firefighters, we need the AL, we need them all. And we need to make sure that we're giving them everything they need to be successful. I sat there with a young couple, they weren't married, which doesn't make any difference, but the point was, they had both been involved in this thing together and they found soulmates together. It was a great thing for them to meet that way, and I kind of commend them. One of them said he's a EMS and paid in Charles County and makes great money up there, plenty of overtime. Again, this EMS fire thing, it's on the horizon, and over the next 4 years, this board will have to deal with it. Secondly is the joint meeting tonight. Again, it's another opportunity for us to speak to our delegates, tell them what's important to us. I always recommend people attend these joint meetings, even if you don't have anything to say. You may learn something, so please, if you have time, come. It starts at 6 p.m. And lastly, the oyster moratorium. That was finally due to a decision, and I'm glad we made one. Now, again, when I see people come in here on a night of our hearing and say, oh, this is NIMBY. This is just people who don't want their view sheds. This is the people who live on the water that want to have their view sheds at the expense of the quality of the bay. It's not that at all. It's people who are concerned about the proliferation of these number of leases. And honestly, it's about DNR and their, I'll use the term, secrecy involved with these things. You ask them where they are, and they'll tell you, well, there's a map. Well, I can't relate that map to the county. Can't you show the county as a whole and then inset that map? No, we don't really want the whole county to know, the lady told me. And she says we put longitude and latitude on there. Now, I don't know if I'm a good longitude, latitude guy, but, you know, I went to the, I got Google like everybody else, and I plugged it in. And that longitude and latitude on listed on their site was in the Gobi Desert in northern China. Now, I'm sure I did it wrong.
There's an oyster dirt there.
Well, again, I'm not sure I did it wrong. But the point is, it's not clear enough for people to know enough about. I just think it's going to take longer. Again, I voted against. It's not that I don't support my fellow commissioners. I do. And it's a majority decision, and I'll support it. But I still say I think it's going to take longer than 6 months to iron this thing out, and I support it. So anyway, hey, happy holidays. My son and daughter-in-law and two grandchildren are back home from Texas, and Colin and Sloaney, I know you're watching. Papa's looking, wants to give you a big hug and a kiss, and thank God you're back in Maryland.
Congratulations on that, Commissioner Hewitt, getting the family back together.
It's always good.
That's good. First, I want to thank our county staff, especially the people Department of Public Works Transportation, and also Parks and Rec for all the good snow clearing they did, and all the staff, the phone call in. I didn't say nothing, I just listened. The staff did a good job of coordinating and making decisions on opening the government and closing school. Of course, closing school, I'm not sure, but I suppose that was the right thing to do. I wasn't traveling the roads, I stayed home. So I didn't, I know I had 4 inches of snow in Clements. I know we had, our dusting turned into 6 inches in most places. So, I mean, it's just, it was hard to predict something like that. And as my wife says, she should have been a weather forecaster because you make mistakes and still get paid. But anyway, with that being said, I joined the Ridge Volunteer Rescue Squads, and we stayed right on through the ugly sweater contest.
Oh, man.
Now, I will say the rest of you have a really tight bar to meet when they came up with that ugly sweater contest.
There's some good sweaters.
It was some good sweaters. It really was. I'm glad I waited that long to watch it and everything, and it was very interesting to pick out the uglier and real ugly sweaters. But it turned out to be a really good presentation, and I got to agree with Commissioner Hewitt. It is a shrinking population, and Some of the people there are pulling unbelievable hours. The top lady who's the chief, over 2,500 hours. That's unbelievable in 1 year time to be a volunteer in the rescue squad department there. That's remarkable. And we do need volunteers to keep on going. If not, we're going to have to address this, like Commissioner Hughes said, later on in our next 4 years here. So please, if you have any desire to be in the rescue squad or fire departments, look it up and volunteer. And this DNR thing, you know, I know we made a decision today. I've been involved in, along with Commissioner Morgan on this focus group. And unfortunately, legislative was passed, and DNR is just focusing on that. They're not really giving much authority to the counties to do anything more than follow their direction. They let us know right up front there that they own all the water. When the mean high tide out, they own it. And unfortunately, though, we in St. Mary's County are looking at the problem is that over 40% of the leases throughout the state are hitting St. Mary's County, and it's growing. And we need to address this issue as quickly as possible. And I'm hoping that we can do that this legislative time period or do something to address this issue to give we here, because this could also hit impact. We have limited access to the water for public, for those who come here and see and vacation in St. Mary's County or come here to visit. And I'd hate to see them put a bunch of these cages out in front of some of our most valuable beaches and limit the use of it. So I am all for doing whatever we can do to stop this going forward. At this time, we've got one more meeting before the end of the year, right? So anyway, we had a good holiday yesterday, and I definitely enjoyed some part of the snow. My wife and I took a walk in the snowstorm for 5 miles while it was snowing. Very interesting. At this time, I need a motion to enter to executive session.
I move to enter an executive session to discuss personnel and CIP issues.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
So moved.